We welcome you this morning to worship at Peace United Church of Christ here in Fort Wayne, Indiana. My name is Kristen Pettit Miller, and I am the pastor here. We had not anticipated that we would be having to move online as quickly as we did, but we want to take care of our community and to keep all of us safe. And so here we are, online, in our homes, ready to share together, wherever we are, the good news of our Advent journey. Let us begin with the lighting of our Advent candles. This morning, we light our first candle, the light of hope. We light our second candle, the light of peace. We light our third candle, the light of joy. And this morning, we light our fourth candle, the light of love. Will you join with me in prayer? Holy God, we await the love that is coming. We await the birth of the child of light. We are thankful and we are grateful as we walk this Advent journey together. Be with us wherever we are. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. That we get to tell our nativity story today, and you are all wearing your masks, and you all look great, and I am taking my mask off right now. It's only because I'm 6 feet away from you, okay? But I thought you could hear me better if I took my mask off, so that's why I'm sitting this far over here, okay? Okay. Okay. Now, normally, you come to this building because it's your school, right? Right? Do you know this building is used for something else?
A church.
Right. On Sundays, we are in this building, a lot of us, and we tell stories and we sing songs. We talk about someone a lot. Does anyone know maybe who that person's name is that we talk about a lot?
David,
that's a good one. Yeah, we talk about David too. Yeah. Baby Jesus, yes. And this is what we're going to talk about. I want to read to you a story today that's one of my favorite stories. Okay, all right. You haven't heard? Okay, that's great. It's always good to hear new stories. So this story, it's called The Nativity. And do you see? What?
Is this for the music set? Because there's a candle
Right, they play music, the organ and the piano. Okay, so I'm going to show you this book, which is one of my very favorite books. Yay! And if you can't see the pictures, hold your hand up and I'll make sure it gets over to you, okay? The words to this is, in the days of Herod, who was a king, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to the city of Nazareth to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph and her name was Mary. Those are big words, aren't they? Do you see that? Can you see the picture?
Yeah.
So, who is, what's that?
An angel.
An angel! I love that angel. Do you see his boots?
By the way, me and Ellie,
angels, yeah, that's where that song comes from. And look at what the angel's doing now. The angel's like flying, but he looks like he's stuck in a tree, sort of. And it says, and the angel said to Mary, hail, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled. Do you know what troubled faces look like? What's a troubled face? What if you were like, oh, troubled face. And so I just love that angel. So next, what's going on at this? Tell me what's happening at this table, at this picture. The angel is sitting with Mary. They're sitting there. It looks like they're having a cup of coffee together, maybe. Maybe not coffee. And it says, the angel said, fear not, for you have found favor with God. And you shall have a son, and you shall name him Jesus. Did you notice also that there's a little chicken right there that's also there? Did you have a question?
We don't have a chicken.
You don't have a chicken?
I don't have a chicken.
Yeah. Okay, so look at these pictures then. What's happening in these pictures? She's getting big. Her tummy's getting big, isn't it? Because she's going to have a baby. That's right. So her tummy's getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And then what's happening in these pictures?
She's at the hospital.
No. Oh, she.
That's why
she's a donkey. They didn't have hospitals then? She's getting on a donkey. And it says that it came to pass that Caesar Augustus agreed that all the world would travel to his own city. So Mary was really pregnant and really uncomfortable, and she had to get on a donkey and go a long way away.
They don't have any cars.
They don't have cars. You're right. That's exactly right. What's happening in this picture?
They're
in the desert. And can you see all the people on donkeys and walking who are going to that town? My goodness. So it says that they went from Nazareth to the city of Bethlehem.
Oh, last time, I told a story about Bethlehem.
Yeah? Now look at this picture. Look at all the people that are in Bethlehem. Can you see? Bethlehem is packed.
I can't.
You can't see it? Here. Who are in Bethlehem. It is insane. They're hanging from the roofs. They're trying to get into buildings. They're sleeping in hammocks. That doesn't look very comfortable, does it?
No.
Uh-oh, and it says, and the time came that Mary was ready to have the baby. So there's Mary and Joseph. It's Mary and Joseph. And guess what? What's in this picture?
The baby!
The baby was born! Look at that picture. There's this little tiny baby who was born. And it says, afterward, they wrapped him in swaddling clothes. That means they just put cloths around him because they didn't have any baby clothes for him. And they laid him in a manger. Do you know what a manger is?
It's a kind of bed.
It has hay in it, and it's where the animals would eat the hay. out of the main, out of this thing, and they turned that into a bed. And just look at this picture. What can you see in this picture?
Chickens.
Well, yeah, chickens, for sure. You know what I see in this picture?
A baby.
A baby, and I see that Mary is very tired. And what's Joseph doing?
He's holding a baby.
He's holding a baby. Yeah.
And the chickens.
And the chickens are there. And then it says that in that there was, in a different part of the country, that there were some sheep and some sheep herders. See, they're taking care of the sheep. And who's coming down out of the sky?
The angel.
The angel with those funny shoes on again. Here comes the angel. And the angel says, you don't need to be afraid. And look at this. Look at, there's even more angels. And the angels are saying, you don't have to be afraid because I bring you good news. On this day in the city of David, a Savior, which is Christ the Lord, is found. And then there were a bunch of angels. They were just flying around. Angels flying and singing. And then, we turn the page. And when the angels were gone, the shepherds said to one another, let us go to Bethlehem to see this. But what is that shepherd saying to that sheep? The shepherd is saying, and what's that mean? He's saying, don't come with us. Don't come with us. We shepherds will go by ourselves. You just stay there. And then what's this picture? Who?
That picture matches the front.
Who do you think is
people.
The shepherds? They went and they found the baby. And look, there they are looking at the baby. Sort of like, you know what? I bet when you were born, I bet you had a lot of people who came in and looked at you. Maybe your grandparents did. Maybe doctors and nurses did. And then it says, and behold then, the wise men to Jerusalem came, saying, where is he that is born the king? And lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them, till it took them where the child was. Do you see those wise men?
Yeah.
What are they riding on?
Donkeys.
No, take, look. Camels, yeah. They had camels. They had a little longer trip. But look, the angel's still with them, and they got stuck on the way. And then it says, when they got into the house where he was born, they saw the young child with Mary, and they fell down, and they worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented him gifts. What gifts? If you were going to come and bring gifts to a baby, what would you bring?
A bottle.
A bottle. I would bring a bottle, too. What else would you bring?
Baby food.
Baby food. A bottle. Baby clothes.
A baby rattle.
Okay, baby toys. Do you know what these guys brought? I mean, these guys brought gold and frankincense, which is something that smells kind of good, and myrrh, which is like a kind of oil. Wouldn't you be kind of bummed out if you got those gifts? Like, you'd kind of be like, I want a toy. I want a bottle. But anyway, that's just what kings do, and they know. We just have to accept that. And then the wise men departed to their own country, and the shepherds also returned, glorifying and praising God. And the angel, and the child was called Angel, or the child was called Jesus, which was so named by the angel. And do you see what's happening in this picture? What's happening? They're getting back on the donkey because where are they going? Back to Bethlehem. So this is the story that we talk about in our church. And we, as Jesus grew up, he told a lot of stories that we like to listen to and follow. And I just wanted to share that story with you today because I really like the pictures in it a lot. So thank you, friends, for listening to the story. And I hope you all have a wonderful holiday, a wonderful...
I'll get lots of candy.
Oh, lots of presents. That's wonderful. Yeah. Okay, I think you can go back with your teachers.
What do you tell Pastor Kristen? What do you say?
You're welcome. This was great.
Want to tell her Merry Christmas?
Merry Christmas! Can I have a hug from you?
Today's scripture is from the first chapter of Luke, the verses 30 through 55. The angel said to her, "Don't be afraid, Mary. God has been gracious to you. You will become pregnant and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High God. The Lord God will make him a king, as his ancestor David was, and he will be the king of the descendants of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." Mary said to the angel, "I am a virgin. How then can this be?" The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and God's power will rest upon you. For this reason, the Holy Child will be called the Son of God. Remember your relative Elizabeth? It is said that she cannot have children, but she herself is now 6 months pregnant, even though she is very old, for there is nothing that God cannot do." "I am the Lord's servant," said Mary. "May it happen to me as you have said." And the angel left her. Soon afterward, Mary got ready and hurried off to a town in the hill country of Judea. She went into Zechariah's house and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby moved within her. Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and said in a loud voice, "You are the most blessed of all women, and blessed is the child you will bear. Why should this thing happen to me that my Lord's mother comes to visit me? For as soon as I heard your greeting, the baby within me jumped with gladness. And how happy you are to believe that the Lord's message to you will come true." Mary said, "My heart praises the Lord. My soul is glad because of God my Savior, for he has remembered me, his lowly servant. From now on, all people will call me happy because of the great things the mighty God has done for me. His name is holy from one generation to another. He shows mercy to those who honor him. He has stretched out his mighty arm and scattered the proud with all their plans. He has brought down mighty kings from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away with empty hands. He has kept the promise he made to our ancestors and has come to the help of his servant Israel. He has remembered to show mercy to Abraham and to all his descendants forever."
Have you ever tried to tell the Christmas story to someone who has legitimately never heard it? It's really rather interesting. So many of us are accustomed to knowing the Christmas story. We feel like we know it from our birth. We heard it growing up. We know it from watching shows on television about it. We know it from even having it read to us in church or in school. But some children have never heard the Christmas story before, especially the younger children who may come from homes that haven't attended church. Some children who are just 3 or 4, or children who can't remember the Christmas story from the year before. Their memories are so short when they are so young. And every once in a while in my years here at Peace Church, as we share our building with the children's nursery school, I get to be the one to tell the Christmas story. But sometimes it's still a little difficult. And let me tell you why. Because I'm always careful to try to explain it in a way that makes sense, to draw attention to the sensory details so that the children can understand. Maybe it's about the feeling of the rough, prickly hay on a baby's skin when they were laid in a manger. Maybe it's how cold it was as the shepherds watched their flocks at night. Maybe it's how frankincense and myrrh smell. All of these small details are things that children can still wrap their heads around. It's part of the wonder of the story. But then, when you really think about it, there are things that I know when I tell the children's story to children I don't know, there are things that I don't say. I refrain from the details to make the story a little more G-rated. I don't want to cause the children in the nursery school classes to ask questions that I don't have answers that I feel comfortable offering yet. For instance, have you ever tried to explain immaculate conception to a child? Have you ever tried to talk about how Joseph isn't technically the biological father of Jesus? Have you ever tried to give details about Herod deciding to kill all the baby boys after Jesus was born? Have you ever tried to explain to a three-year-old that Mary may have been the age of their older sister when the angel Gabriel came calling? The thing is, though, I've come to believe that the Christmas story has too often been sanitized, not just for our young listeners, but perhaps for our own ears as well. There are so many parts of that story that are steeped in mystery. Parts that we don't understand, parts which make us uncomfortable, maybe more than we would be willing to admit. There are times when we prefer our Christmas story with a priestly bend rather than a prophetic one. And this morning's scripture is a perfect example. The verse that Luke penned in the last part of the first chapter of his gospel start with a story of Mary, but then they become the words of the prophet Mary, spoken straight from her lips shortly after cousin Elizabeth had confirmed the blessing of Mary's pregnancy. The words offer us a little insight about this young woman, and remember, she was very young, who had been chosen to give birth to the Christ. And this proclamation is spoken only after Mary had wrapped her own head around this wondrous event, which will shape not only the course of her life, but the course of world history. In these words that Mary speaks, also known as Mary's Magnificat, we get a glimpse of revolution, of an alternate future which is poised to be birthed with the coming of Jesus. On this, the fourth Sunday of Advent, as we are finishing up our gift wrapping and we're preparing to sing the soft carols, imagining a Christmas perhaps out of a Thomas Kincaid photo with snow falling gently, our lectionary offers us this prophetic revelation, one that we might consider the least likely to hear. And it's spoken from one that we hardly think of as a prophet, the meek and mild Mary. On this fourth Sunday of Advent, after we have been encouraged to wait and to prepare and then to wait some more, we are given this gospel truth. On this fourth Sunday of Advent, as we rush to listen, to get to that beautiful Christmas story that we have practically memorized and that we know we will hear on Christmas Eve, the one that begins, "And it came to pass," there is first this moment of poetry that we dare not ignore. Mary's Magnificat is similar in literary style to that of Hannah, a matriarch of old, who spoke her own prophecy about a child growing in her womb. It's told in the first book of Samuel. And it's a song of liberation, a cry for justice, and it is sung in solidarity with all people who struggle. She has only spoken in scripture before with passive acceptance. "Let it be done," were the words that Mary said. But now we have a new perspective. "Let it be done," a quiet whisper of yes, turns into a proclamation. Hear verses 51 through 53 spoken in the contemporary vernacular of Eugene Peterson's Bible, The Message. Mary says, "God bared his arm and showed God's strength, scattered the bluffing braggarts. God knocked the tyrants off their high horses, pulled victims out of the mud. The starving poor sat down to a banquet. The callous rich were left out in the cold." These are not the words of a passive young woman here. This isn't a quiet Mary who accepts with resignation a fate that she isn't certain about. Instead, Mary is an active participant in naming oppression and injustice. It's no wonder that Jesus became the prophet that he was, for I imagine that he learned a great deal at the knee of his mother, a woman who spoke of transformation and liberation, a woman who believed that her child's destiny was to speak God's words as well. The truth of Mary is this: in the church, we have sanctified or perhaps even sanitized her. So many of our contented nativity scenes of Mary have her pictured with blonde hair in a blue dress. She smiles in bemused acceptance, and we forget that there is more to her. We forget, for instance, that she was a peasant woman. We forget that her skin was not white. She was a woman who gave birth by herself in a stable with no midwife on hand. A woman who would have had to direct Joseph in the ways of helping to give birth. A woman who was not merely a vessel of the divine, not merely a conduit of the holy, but a prophet in her own right. Mary was a woman who had the audacity to say yes to the unimaginable. She could have said no. She had every right to say no. But instead, she uttered that single, simple, powerful yes. She preached of a world that would come through her child's birth and through his leadership. The writer Madeline L'Engle writes of Mary's legacy in this way. She says of Christmas, "This is the irrational season, when love blooms bright and wild. Had Mary been filled with reason, there would have been no room for the child." This morning, I wonder how we can embrace this irrational season and Mary's revolutionary words for ourselves. How do we make the Magnificat our own personal manifesto, our own proclamation for peace on earth? I collect articles from different magazines, and one of them that I read regularly is The Christian Century. Because I'm a natural clipper and saver, I am a pack rat for words. And this week, when I opened my file on Advent and Christmas quotes, I ran across this article that I had cut out 6 years ago about Mary and the power of Mary's song. The writer of the article is a Lutheran pastor by the name of John Stendel. And he writes about our reclamation of the Magnificat in this way. He says, "As grateful as I am for Mary's example and companionship, there is something I worry about. The Magnificat may move with us with its dreams of retributive justice, but do we make imaginative solidarity with Mary only to domesticate her to our decidedly inexpensive fantasies of peace on earth? Are we drawn to consider what this will cost us and to begin paying the price?" He goes on to write, "I pray that we who have much of the world's goods and power will hear Mary's words about the proud and the rich as warnings and as salutary threats that we must consider. If we are able to sing those words lustily, let it be because we are seduced by the grandeur and the grace of salvation that she describes. But let it also join us to those who yearn for a turning of the socioeconomic tables. The Magnificat is a powerful piece of writing, and it is not for the wishy-washy of faint. It is as revolutionary today as it was when it was spoken by an unknown peasant girl who lived in a Roman-occupied country. It even had the power to threaten heads of state in Guatemala in the 1980s when it was barred from being preached because it was deemed too subversive or too radical to read in public." And I kind of think that's the way all of our scripture should be. Maybe that's the way our faith should be. Perhaps what we need to be about, if we are welcoming the Christ child into the world, is to truly proclaim the Magnificat with mind, body, and soul at the very core of our being. Perhaps we must take seriously the call to stand in solidarity with all who are downtrodden, whether that be economically or spiritually. Perhaps we must be utterly single-minded about the toppling of systems of oppression and racism and injustice. Perhaps Mary's call, this call for a turning of the tables, a call for the inversion of the dominant structure, a call for the revolution of the world, has to be something that the church is always considering. This revelation and this revolution is not for the faint of heart, but ushering in new life rarely is. Being called to join Mary as bearers of God isn't easy. Not all of us may be able to do it. But can we as a church afford to be any other way if we truly believe in the kingdom of peace? The writer Nancy Mayers sums up our mission pretty simply when she writes these words. "That's what we're here for, to make the world new. We know what to do. Seek justice, Love mercy, walk humbly, treat every person as if she were yourself. These are not complicated instructions. In fact, it's much harder to decipher the directions for putting together a child's tricycle than to understand these. Friends, in this Advent season, we have waited and we've pondered and we've listened and we've prepared. We have prepared well in this Advent season. And now Mary's voice pierces the silence with a clear call. Let us prepare for the birth of Christ. Let us labor to bring the reign of peace to all. Amen. Pray. How silently the wondrous gift will be given. May we be silent now, our God, and expectant that we may receive the gift. The gift that will be coming to us to change us and to bring new light into this world. Amen. Amen. And now, my friends, go out into your own worlds, into your own lives, and ponder this week what the revolution and the revelation has to teach you. Amen.